to call your attention to the book of St. Mark, the 5th chapter, the 19th verse. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but said unto him, Go home to thy friends, and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and he hath had compassion on thee. A wild man meets Jesus. A wild man meets Jesus. Jesus had turned from his Galilean ministry and had embarked upon a little ship headed across the blue waters of the Galilee, or the Sea of Galilee, where he alighted upon the shores of Assyria near the little town of Gadara.
Yes.
And when he walked down upon the sandy beach of this country, there met him a man who was insane.
Yes.
A man who was mentally deranged. A man who was feeble-minded. Sick mentally. Regarded by his contemporaries as being a man of an unclean spirit. Now, this man was wrecked from the standpoint of mentality, from the standpoint of personality. He was wrecked. And there is no wreck worse than a human wreck. There are other kinds of wrecks, and they are, for the most part, tragic. But none of them exceed in tragedy the wreck of humanity. You see. But this man was fortunate in that he met Jesus. He met Jesus. No doubt there was the gleam of insanity in his eyes. We know that his hair was disarranged. We know that his features were distorted from his mental disturbance, and that his body was gashed and bleeding, because day and night he ran restlessly among the tombs. Listen, if you please. This man had armbands and chains dangling from his wrist and from his legs, for nothing had been sufficient to hold him. According to the story, he had busted fetters and chains. In his restless tirade, day and night. Now, listen if you please. Chains could not hold him. Iron bands could not hold him. As we think about this outmoded method of dealing with this problem of feeble-mindedness, it makes us think with a lot of regret that until recently, we had not improved too much upon the methods of these ancient Assyrians in dealing with the problem of insanity and feeble-mindedness. We resorted to methods of force, attempting to restore health and to restore sanity and to restore balanced personality. We have learned through the years that it takes something more than punishment and force to restore mental health. We must approach it with efficiency, with Jesus as our example. His method was advanced in that day, and it's up to date today. When Jesus met the man, he did not exhibit fear. He did not exhibit curiosity. He did not withdraw from the man. But there, as a man saw him and Jesus saw him, Jesus called out to him, "Young man, what is your name?" What is your name?
Oh, yes.
Oh, you know that today, most people who are dealing with problems, human problems, and especially that type of problem, would not have approached this man as did Jesus on this occasion. Somehow fear would seize us, or if we dealt with him, we would deal with him impatiently, or we would deal with him with inconsideration. But calmly and kindly and considerately, Jesus said to him those consoling and caressing words, "What is your name?" What is your name? Whenever there are psychopathic and psychiatric problems, there is a way that they must be dealt with. Especially if we expect to do anything toward the restoration of that person. What is your name? It is said that in dealing with a problem of this sort, that psychiatrists and psychologists try to first of all reach the mentality, the mind, with some degree of order of the victim, and try to lead him back through the past and connect him up with something that is important in the past. So this approach of Jesus deals fundamentally with this approach. Jesus tried, in other words, to connect the young man with his family. The family name. Young man, what is your name? I don't believe you're praying with me tonight. If he could recall his family name, why, he could remember a father. If he could remember his name, he could remember a mother. If he could remember his name, he no doubt could remember other relatives that were dear to him. If he could recall his name, he could recall a home. For previously, he could not rest at home. His dwellings were among the tombs. I don't believe you know what I'm talking about. His dwellings were among the tombs. Listen, if you please. People today, like this young man of Gadara, some of them are still living among the tombs of the past. Some of them are still placing and laying dead hands of the past upon the living present, because they live in the past. Some people are still wandering among the tombs of the past. Some people cannot live an advanced life. Some people cannot embrace the challenge of today. They are still howling and reminiscing among the tombs of the past. Some people are still hauling themselves and trying all they know how
people to the ways of the past. Some of their ways and some of their methods and some of their institutions are outmoded and outdated and a back number, already living beyond its time. And the only reason why those approaches and those practices are still being carried on is because there are some people today are living in the past and keeping them alive. Much of the world is suffering today. Thousands and millions of people in the world are suffering today and are going hungry today and being denied their rights today because too many people are still living in the past, still wandering among the tombs of the past. You ought to hear Jesus saying to you today, "What is your name?" The mentally deranged man said, or this evil spirit in him said, "My name is Legion." In other words, I'm not by myself. I'm one body, but there are other voices in me. I'm one body, but there are legions of spirits within me. I'm one body, but mentally, I'm many. There is at war in my mind. Legions of conflicts. That's my name. I am a multiplicity of confusion. I believe it's somebody listening to me tonight who feel that way. It's somebody who listened to me tonight whose minds are at war, whose spirits or who have spirits within them, tying their lives and rendering their whole personality into twisted and confused conflict. Jesus is saying to you tonight, what is your name? Jesus is offering to you tonight inner peace. Jesus is offering to you tonight the mercy of calming those conflicting voices and laying at ease those warring spirits in your mind and in your life and in your soul. I wish you'd pray with me tonight. The man cried out, "What have thou to do with me, thou son of the Most High?" Oh, that question has been repeated by individuals and nations who meet the altering, who come in conflict or in contact or face to face with the altering personality of Jesus, with the adjusting influence of Jesus Christ, and hear him inquiring as to their disorderliness. And they are saying, "Jesus, what have you to do with me?" Remember, he has a lot to do with anyone and can do a lot for anyone. For he can give your mind peace. He can bring new meaning and new purpose into your life. He can make your life worthwhile and make it significant. He can not only make it worthwhile and significant, but he can make your life an abundant life, a productive life, and a helpful life. If you'd only surrender as did this restless man. This man had seen no peace and had known no peace as long as he had not come in contact with Jesus. But he finds himself at the feet of Jesus. He sees and realizes that he is face to face with a superior personality and with a superior power. And he bows at the feet of Jesus. Pray with me if you please. And the evil spirits refuse, temporarily at least, to dislodge themselves from this man's life. Satan does not willingly give up any life. Satan does not voluntarily give up any life. No matter how much damage he's doing in that life, no matter how much trouble and restlessness he's causing, he does not abandon that life with ease and willingly. Why, no more than he did in the life of this young man.
Yes.
But remember that Jesus has the power to order him out,
yes,
whether he comes out willingly or not.
Yes.
Jesus demanded the evil spirits come on out of the man.
Yes.
And Satan in his legion of numbers said, if you're going to make me leave the young man, there are some hogs over there,
yes,
grazing by the sea. And if you don't mind, let me go over there and dwell in those swine. Jesus gave his permission. And Satan doesn't want to be put out of the church no matter where he is. No more than he wants to be put out of a life. If you find him in the choir, you want to get a... If you're going to put him out of the choir, you'd like to get on the usher board. Oh, Lord. If you find him on the deacon board and put him off there, you want to work in the Sunday school. He doesn't want to leave altogether. He feels that as long as he's around, he has another strike at you and another chance at you. Oh, Lord. And... Why, when Satan went into the hogs, he made them run off into the sea,
yes,
and drowned themselves. The owners of the swine came out and heard what Jesus had done and ordered him from that course. They gave him an eviction notice. They told him to leave their shores. But those blind Gadareans valued hams higher than humans. I don't believe you know what I'm talking about. They valued hams higher than humans. Oh, Lord, the only thing that they were able to see was not a man restored in his right mind. No, they weren't able to see that orderliness that had come into that life. No, they weren't able to appreciate the man was in his right mind now, sitting down with his hair arranged and with his clothes on, calm and restful. Oh, Lord, they ignored all of that and ordered Jesus out. But the young man looked at Jesus and said, don't send me away. I want to go along with you. I'd like to join your band and become one of your disciples. Oh, Lord, you've done so much for me. I want to follow you wherever you go. I don't even know what I'm talking about. But I heard Jesus say, no, they've already ordered me out. Yes, they have. They've already given me my eviction notice. And if you leave, the light will go out in Galleria. Oh, Lord, go home and tell your friends. Oh, Lord, you can do more for me at home than you can follow me around. Go home. I wish you knew what I was talking about tonight. Go home and tell your friend. Go home. You left home insane. Go on back in your right mind. You left home running zigzag. Go back walking in a straight line. Oh, Lord. You left home unhappy. Go back with love and peace in your heart. Oh, Lord. Yeah. Go home and tell your friends. Go home and tell your family. Go home and tell your children. Go home and tell your mother. Go home and tell your father what great thing the Lord has done for you. Oh, Lord, I think we could follow the young man's example. Yes, we could. We ought to go home in Detroit today. You ought to go home. Yeah! Your husband needs need to know about Jesus. Yeah. Oh, I go home and tell your husband about him. Lord God, go home and tell your children about him. Jesus. I don't think you know what I'm talking about yet. Oh, Lord. Tell them when you get home, the Lord is a way provider. The Lord is a light in the house. Tell them now. We should open the door. When every door has been closed in your face, the Lord is a rock in the way. The Lord is a way out. Close for you. Ah! Ah, go home. Ah, go home. Ah, go home. Ah, go home. Yeah, go home. Tell the Lord. Tell the world. Tell it wherever you go. Lord, in my everything. All right at home. And if it's all right with you, it's all right with your family. Let everybody, everybody, go on home. Tell what good things the Lord has done for you. Heard the voice of Jesus saying,
why don't you sing?